of your light, and that darkness cannot overcome it. For all who bear witness to your light, we give you thanks. Help us to speak the truth, to show acts of love, to have understanding as we relate to others, to be kind and gracious in our homes, and to be seekers for justice in our society. Make us more like Jesus Christ our Lord, and may his light illuminate our own darkness. Amen.
As we're seated, if anyone has a prayer card, now's the time that Karen will collect those. Did anyone have a prayer card today?
And now let us join in the confession and pardon. We come before God not as despised sinners, but as beloved children. With the confidence of children of God, let us humbly confess our sin. O Lord our God, you call us to proclaim the gospel, but we remain silent in the presence of evil. You call us to be reconciled to you and one another, but we are content to live in separation. You call us to seek the good of all, but we fail to resist the powers of oppression. You call us to fight pretensions and injustice, but we sit idly by, endangering the lives of people far and near. Forgive us, O Lord. Reconcile us to you by the power of your Spirit, and give us the courage and strength to be reconciled to others Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. Our righteousness is found in Christ alone, a gift of God by faith. Beloved people of God, believe the good news and say with me this next line: through the grace of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Pass the peace of Christ to one another. The peace of Jesus Christ be with you.
There's one little girl.
Thank you.
It amazes me every time they play that so many bells have to work in conjunction down to the half second and millisecond. What a gift our bell choir is. Amen. Regan, you want to come forward? Yeah? I think we only have one child. Will you sit with me? Thank you, Lynn. I never like it to be just one or two children. That's why I invite an adult up too, because we're all children at heart. That doesn't mean we have to be childlike, but yeah. How are you, Regan?
Good.
Good? Well, I'm glad you're here today. And how are you?
I'm just fine.
I'm glad you're here today too. I'm glad to see all of you today. Wonderful to see so many folks worshiping. And I noticed we have some of our last snowbirds have flown home. Finally, praise be to God. We're so glad you're home. And I also want to attend to the fact that we are blessed, friends, to be in the presence of the retired Reverend in the back. Dan, it is good to have you here. Our friend from First Baptist has just retired. So good. So good to have you both with us this morning. So good to have all of you. So good. So good. So today in the Big People's Sermon, we're going to be talking about kindness. So I saw this video online, and it made me giggle. Can I tell you about it? So there was a big sister and a little sister, and the little sister wanted the red crayon that the big sister had. And someone, mom or dad or someone, was recording this little conversation. And the big sister is saying to the little sister, "You have to say it right. May I," and the little girl said, "May I, please have the red crayon. The red crayon." Say it all together. "May I have the red crayon?" You forgot please. "May I please have the red crayon?" No. The big sister said no. She worked so hard to help her little sister have good manners, and then when it came down to it, "No, you may not have the red crayon. Thank you for asking." What do you think about this? What would you do?
I would go tell my parents that she wasn't sharing with me.
Oh, we're going to go tell someone that she's not sharing. So if you were the big sister and the little sister said, "May I please have the red crayon?" You would give it to her?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think that's the good thing. That's the kind thing to do. Now, what if you are asking, or let me back up. Let's say that I'm asking you for the red crayon, but you just got it from Lynn. Now, you just got it. So there's another option here, right? You could say, "Yes, I will share it with you next. Just give me 1 second." Would that be kind? Yeah. Sometimes when we're being kind, that doesn't mean we just have to forget ourselves. Because if you've been waiting on the red crayon and you have a pretty apple that you want to color red, then maybe you want to color your apple real quick. So it's okay to say, being kind doesn't mean that I always have to give up what I want. It can also be that you can have what you want and the other person can get the crayon as well. So we're not going to talk about crayons necessarily, but I just thought that was such a funny video, that the big sister worked so hard and the little sister worked so hard, and the end was just simply, nope. I don't think that's kindness. Do you? Yeah. Yeah. We have to keep working on being kind. It's not easy all the time, isn't it? Yeah, because some people get on our nerves. They bug us. They annoy us, right? And we have to really work to be kind to some people. So that's the challenge for this week. So you're still in school, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have a few more days, a couple weeks left, right? Have you counted down the days yet?
Thursday I had 2 more weeks.
Oh, you're less than 2 weeks now. So you're going to have plenty of opportunities to be kind in the next 2 weeks. Especially be kind to the teachers and the staff and the principal and if you ride the bus driver, because they are very tired. right? Any of the teachers or former teachers and administrators, very, very tired.
Definitely.
So lots of time to be kind. And that's what we're going to work on. Will you work on that this week with me? Will you all do it as well? There's a bigger challenge coming. You better say yes to the easy one. Let's pray. Will you pray with me? Pray with me too. Loving God.
Loving God.
Thank you for helping us.
Thank you for helping us.
To see times to be kind.
To see times to be kind.
Help us be kind to others.
Help us to be kind to others.
And to be kind to ourselves.
And to be kind to ourselves.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Thank you so much. I'm glad you were here. It would have been lonely talking to myself today. Praise God for this child in our midst. Amen.
Amen. Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Great and loving God, tend the soil of our hearts as we receive your word today, so that we will bear the fruit of kindness in our being and in our doing. Amen. Today's Old Testament reading is from Micah 6, verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? The epistle reading is from Titus, chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. Remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient and to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle and to show every courtesy to everyone. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, despicable, hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of any works of righteousness that we had done, but according to his mercy, through the water of rebirth and the renewal by the Holy Spirit. This Spirit he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is the word of God.
This morning I share a gospel reading with you, and I'm going to invite you to close your eyes. I'm going to be sharing from Luke 6 from the Common English Bible, and I want you to picture the scene. Jesus is here teaching his disciples. And it's a pretty common sense lesson, but one we all need to hear. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. And if you lend to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full. But love your enemies. Do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, because he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Though the grass may wither and the flowers may fade, the word of God endures forever. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Holy and living Lord, speak now your words to us in ways that we can hear you, in ways we can understand you, in ways that we can be changed by you. And somehow, Lord, make my words your words. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So here we are at the exact midpoint of our 9-week sermon series on the fruit of the Spirit. Good fruit. I don't know about you, but I've been challenged by the fruit so far. And frankly, I've noticed some fruit that's getting a little bad in my basket. I don't know about you. It's challenging to think about these qualities. And today, we continue on the journey. And the whole idea here is that if we are bearing fruit, we need to take a look at the fruit we're bearing. And if we say we're bearing fruit, then we probably should make sure that we are alive and healthy to bear that fruit. Today, kindness. I've struggled this week. Kindness is not very clearly defined in the Bible. And you think, what? I didn't say it's not a Christian concept. It is. Clearly important enough for Paul to mention this in his list of spiritual fruit. But what does it mean to be kind? How is kindness the same as other words we use, like compassion, or empathy, or love, or mercy, or grace, or goodness? I want to show two extremes here, if you will. The first is a wonderful book that I read several years ago. Those of you who know me well know that I'm an avid reader, and I particularly love to watch movies based on books and critique them at how poorly they did. I'm that book snob. I saw a movie recently based upon a book that I had read, and I could not complain. A Man Called Otto was the name of the book in the U.S. A Man Called Ove is how it was translated into English from the original Swedish book. Frederick Bachman tells the story of Ove, or in the U.S., Otto, O-T-T-O, as he says in the movie. And Otto's a grumpy old man. In this particular movie, Otto finds himself in a place of deep, deep sadness. His wife died just 6 months earlier, and Otto wants to die too. He's done with life. He cannot see his way forward in life without the love of his life. And he lives in this perfect little homeowners group where all of the houses are perfect, and the signs for parking are perfect, and the driveway is perfect, and it's clearly marked. And anyone who doesn't do things like Otto wants them to do is clearly an idiot. And he will tell that person to their face just how stupid they are. Otto particularly has it out for the Die, D-Y-E, America. You hear the words together, Die America. And he doesn't like this property ownership group that's trying to take over everything in his world and the world of those around him. He also is at odds with his once best friend. Why? Because he had to vote against Otto being the chair of the homeowners association. That's part of it. The other part is he wouldn't drive a Chevy. He drove Fords. And then, Toyotas. Otto is a man of means, it seems, but he lives simply. Otto is not very kind, but Otto is helpful. As he sees his new neighbors backing their little U-Haul trailer into the parking space, he cannot help but to grumble about how stupid the man is. He should know at least how to back up a trailer, and they should be driving a standard and not an automatic. And as they back the trailer into the curb, Otto has had enough, and he says, "Get out, get out, get out." And he does it himself, and he looks in the back seat, and there are their two children that he has to greet. He's helpful, but he's not kind. If you've not seen the movie, go see the movie. It's on Netflix, I believe. On the other side of that is what I call the myth of Christian kindness. Now hear me out. How many of you have been in a place where kindness has been demanded of you in ways that have caused you to go without the things that you want and need in life? How many of you have heard this myth of kindness, that good Christian people are kind and giving, right? Anyone there? And we do hold this tension between a mandate to be kind and Jesus' mandate that we love one another with the same love that we offer to ourselves. So we have Otto on one end of the spectrum, very helpful, but not kind. And on the other end of the spectrum, we might find ourselves living into the myth of Christianity where we become doormats for people. Where if someone says or does something to us that is wrong or offensive, the good Christian image in us says we should just be still, right? No. Kindness is not about being someone's doormat. I've heard the saying, and you've heard it too, do no harm, but take no... Kindness is being helpful while having the heart of Jesus, a heart that loves us all. The illustration that I shared with Reagan this morning about the crayon is a simple way to look at it, right? If you've just gotten the crayon and you've been waiting for, you may not want to give it to someone right now, and that's okay. Maybe you need to collar your apple first. That's okay. We cannot abandon the mandate to love self because we are of great value to God. Now, this is counter what many of us have been taught. Most of us, I imagine, have been taught that us good Christian people ought to keep our mouths shut and just do whatever we can so as not to cause waves. But I believe as those who are created in the image of God, who bear the imprint and presence of God, that we have a holy obligation to make sure we're not losing ourselves in the midst of helping others. We cannot pour from an empty glass. I heard just a few moments ago a confession, but I don't take it as a confession. I take it as a profession. Not a confession of sin, but a profession of faith that the food had been in the basket was given to people on our street, the people who were under our portico during the week because this week they found themselves hungry. Was it wrong to take from the basket? Absolutely not. There was kindness there. There was being helpful while having the heart of Jesus. I believe that God wants us to be kind. But I don't believe that God wants us to be in a place where we bend over backwards to the point of breaking, because then we're not being kind to the God who resides in us. We are not taking care of ourselves. And when we have that place of emptiness and we have that place where we're not kind to ourselves, we will become bitter. We will become angry. We will resent those we're trying to help. And that is not in any way reflective of biblical understandings of kindness. So what is kindness? I offer only two words today, and I want you to remember these words this week. The first is that kindness is contagious. Say it with me. Kindness is contagious. I wonder what the world might look like. I wonder if we treated kindness not as a feeling, but as an action. I don't know about you, but I've never caught someone feeling kind. Instead, I see their actions. I see the actions that show me that they are kind. When I was interviewing here, I had a firsthand lesson in kindness from my tour guide and driver, Gary Patterson. Gary took me to Wawa, and Gary taught me Wawa culture. Now, I kind of had to go, because where I come from, we hold the door open for everyone, not just at Wawa. Where I come from, it's common courtesy, right? And where I come from, men don't walk through doors that women are holding, which I think is a problem. I walked through one the other day that a woman was holding, and the world kept on spinning. But Wawa culture, friends, is an image of what it looks like for us to see contagious kindness. You hold the door for someone, and someone holds the door from you. There is a weird, strange spirit in Wawa that, frankly, I haven't felt in most churches I've attended in my life. I'm just telling the truth. What would it look like if we really believed that kindness is contagious in that way? Maybe kindness could be a part of our vision of the kingdom of God. That contagious kindness can spread from one person to another until it takes over the world. Oh, I think that type of kindness we see in the Bible. That kindness does not say, someone held the door open for me, and now I'm going to close the door behind me. You can open it yourself. Which is sadly the message that much of our world seems to exude. What would happen if kindness were this contagious? I remember several years back when it first started that someone began paying it forward. That was the phrase, right? Do you remember when that emerged? And you would pay for the order of the McDonald's order behind you, right? And then it would keep going. Now, this became frustrating to the cashiers who were trying to keep track of orders and money. But there was kindness there. There's kindness in a coffee shop that I went to one time in D.C. where people can put a cup on reserve. They could buy a cup of coffee for someone who needs a cup of coffee and can't pay for it. Our friends with no means. But there's also a lesson here, and a funny one. Don't mess with old people. There was the lady who went through the drive-thru, and she paid for the order behind her, and this woman behind her had just beeped on the horn, and just really aggressive. So the little sweet lady, she insisted on paying for their order at the first window. And when she got to the second window, she took her order and theirs. Not helpful or kind. But kindness is contagious. Have you seen it in your own life? Have you felt that contagious spirit of kindness? And the second is, kindness is to be celebrated. Say it. I wonder what would happen if we move from cancel culture to celebration culture. Don't get me wrong, there are some people who need canceled. And I'm okay with that. But here's what I'm not okay with. I'm not okay with this spirit that says, I've been to this restaurant 60 times, and one time they got my food wrong. So I'm going to be a Facebook warrior, and I'm going to leave a review that's scathing. It happens. People's livelihoods are put on the line. The restaurant's business is likely going to suffer. All because your potato wasn't right. We don't celebrate kindness. We celebrate criticism in our culture. Maybe we could start putting people on blast for the good that they do. Maybe we could write that review on Facebook because the meal was great. And the server was kind. Even when the server was slow because the restaurant was packed and no one else would show up to work, we can still leave a review and show some kindness. Maybe, we Christians could move in that way today. I have so many friends who've waited for years and years, some career servers who say Sunday lunch is their worst hour of the week. Because of all the church people who come. Good, well-meaning church people who come to praise Jesus and they leave their buck on the table after their meal. Not offering a smile, a word of kindness, a word of appreciation, and certainly not a tip worthy of food today. Of the costs of housing today. These are simple things, friends. But these simple acts can be celebrated, and when they are celebrated, they will become contagious. I don't know about you. I know my audience here. I'm guessing not a whole lot of you are on TikTok. But I know a lot of you are on Facebook because we're friends, and you share things. And on Facebook, they're called Reels, or on TikTok, you get these little videos, and I get sucked in. Anyone? You'll watch one video, and one turns to five, and all of a sudden, you've wasted 3 hours doing nothing but watching tiny little videos, and you're looking around like, what in the world happened? A black hole sucked us in to these videos. There are videos that I particularly like, though. I like the cat videos. I like the goat videos. If you've not found goat TikTok or goat reels, they're amazing, especially the little fainting goats. But the ones I like most are the random acts of kindness. The guy will go up and say to the woman in the Walmart, I will give you $100, or I'll give you $500, and you give it to everyone, to someone else, five other people. And almost without exception, they're going to take the $500 to share it. And then usually at the end of the video, the guy says, you were so kind. Why'd you do that? And it's usually something to the effect of, well, I just think it would be kinder to share that money with others because there are people who need it. And almost without exception, the videographer will then say, here's $500 for you. It's the kid who walks up to the guy he knows from social media. And he knows that the guy just posted a video saying, find me, and I will help you. And the kid gets a computer that they really need for school. Or the woman gets the grocery gift card to feed the family. Random acts of kindness. People who do not know each other. Spreading kindness in a way that is contagious and to be celebrated without ever mentioning God, Christ, or the church. Now, friends, if we say we have the best news in the world to share, and we say we are to share that with joy, oh, what a vision that we might be the ones who can celebrate a contagious kindness with the world. Oh, that we might be the ones who others see as the kind ones in their midst. It's not easy. That's why we had to be told. Jesus teaches the disciples this lesson in the passage. Great. You're kind to other people who are kind to you. Whoop-de-doo. Great. You give money to those who give money to you. Super. You pray for those who pray for you. Wonderful. It's a whole different situation, though, when our courageous, celebratory kindness is called upon to those who don't offer us kindness, to those who don't offer us love, to those who may not like us, to those we don't understand, to those on our portico who may intimidate us. But that is the call of the gospel. Kindness to the whole world. May that be our goal this week. I challenge you, find a point in the week to offer a random act of kindness to someone. I don't know what that's going to be. Maybe it's giving someone $5. I don't usually give cash, but you drive up at the stoplight and see the man begging for food while you're wearing this. It's no different for you. You just don't wear the collar. Kindness opportunities are all around us, friends. I guarantee this week, if you take a step of courage to offer courageous kindness, the kind that we can celebrate, that is contagious, we will change the world, even if it's just one person's world for one day. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Will you please rise if you are able and join with me in the affirmation of faith? In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. We trust in God whom Jesus called Abba, Father. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere, the giver and renewer of life. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives. Even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, come, Lord Jesus. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God. In Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
You may be seated. Let's sing and pray. It again. In these moments, we center ourselves in the presence of Almighty God. We give God thanks for the kindness that God has shown us. We give God praise for the ways that others have been kind to us this week and throughout our lives. We acknowledge our need to work on kindness in our own lives. And we think about those persons who may be difficult, the ones it's hard to be kind to, and we ask God to help us. We pray that God might help us to live in charity and steadfast love. And I invite you to look at the prayer concern list on the back of your bulletin. These are persons and situations that we're asking God to tend to. We trust in God's kindness, God's mercy, and God's grace. Take a moment and pray for the names that stand out for you. We also lift in prayer those who've come through in the prayer cards and before worship, especially for John Dumas, for Addie, for Sue Lindbergh. For Sue DeCero. For Reed Beveridge. For others that we name now in our hearts or aloud. And now we pray that prayer which Jesus taught his disciples so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, Amen. At this time, I'm going to invite Heather to come forward. Heather, have you made your way out of the balcony? Oh, there she is. Heather, come forward. And Julia? And Laurie's making her way. We are so blessed by Heather's great big heart. Heather leaves tomorrow for a trip to the Democratic Republic of Congo, where she, along with five others from our presbytery, will go to minister, to build relationships, and to share. And Heather represents us, no pressure.
Right?
But most of all, Heather represents the great kindness of Jesus Christ. So we want to send her with our blessing. And we have some things here that Heather's going to be taking along with her. These are crosses that Heather will share with the deacons and the elders of our sister church from our deacons and elders. And I am sharing a stole that has been with me many, many years for their pastor. It was handmade by a mission group in West Virginia. And we have a very, very special stole. Julia, tell us what this is about. We're going to get cozy.
So, Judy Worley and I made this stole, and this side represents our covenant with our presbytery. It's the logo of the Newcastle Presbytery, and this represents our covenant with our Congo Church. So that will be presented to her.
And what a gift Judy and Julia have that they share with Heather and with our sister church. And we are called upon in Scripture to lay hands on those as they're sent out in service, for those who need healing, for those who need God's blessing. So we're going to lay hands on Heather. And I'm going to invite particularly our elders and deacons, if you will come forward. And that's all of our elders and deacons. And then if you're not an elder and deacon and still want to participate in the blessing, just raise your hand of blessing to Heather. And if you can't touch Heather, touch the closest person by you. Reverend, will you join us? You might be retired, but you still got blessings in you, I know. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we give you thanks for Heather and her great big heart. We pray, O Lord, that you may bless her. Bless her comings and her goings throughout this trip. Bless her and her friends with safety, with wisdom, with joy. We pray for the gifts that we are sending, that you may bless them. Bless the crosses and those who wear them. Bless these two stoles as they remind those who minister in that place that they are yoked with you and we are all yoked together with Christ. We pray, Lord, that in all things Heather may be drawn closer to you and that this group that's going may be drawn closer to one another. Help us see the importance of building these relationships with people who look different than us and think differently than us, who may worship differently than us. And we pray especially for Heather as she brings the word of God to these people through a sermon. In all things, O Lord, we give you glory. And we know that you will be glorified in the service of those who represent the presbytery, especially with Heather. And bring her back with rejoicing and help her to share the story with us. This we pray in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Heather, thank you. Thanks, Laurie. At this time, we will give God the gifts that God has first given to us. You've had an opportunity to place your gift in the offering plate, but if you did not do that and have a gift to give, simply raise your hand and an usher will be by. Let us give to God what is God's. Let us pray. Almighty God, by your grace, accept the fruit of our labor and the offering of our lives. Let us be a sacrifice of thanksgiving in union with the risen Lord, who lives and reigns with you forever. Amen. Our next hymn is a three-part hymn. And Heather, we're going to do this the first part, the first line twice, then the second line twice, then the third line twice, and then?
Then we're going to sing all together in harmony.
In harmony. So some of you will sing part one, some of you will sing part two, and those of us up here will sing three. I'll sing part three. Okay, so then two and one's going down. We're going to learn this together. And which is part one? Part one is over here, and part two is here, but we'll all sing all three at first. If it's confusing to you, that's okay. It's confusing to us as well. We're going to praise God anyways. So the first line, here we go.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you?
Sing it again.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you?
Then line two.
Justice, kindness, walk humbly with our God.
Sing it again.
Justice, kindness, walk humbly with our God.
Third line.
To seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God.
Sing it again.
To seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God.
Now the split parts.
What does the Lord require? To seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God.
Sing out.
To seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly.
One more time.
To seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God.
What does the Lord require of us, friends? But to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with God. Oh, may that be our pursuit this week and throughout our lives. Go. Go with the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit resting in you and giving you abundant joy for all your journeys. And God's people said, Amen. Amen.